Hi, this is Jeremiah from the Bigfoot Society podcast and sharing some recorded audio I have for you today from the Van Meter Visitor Festival. Cool thing is, there is you have a wide variety of speakers, but this year we had a talk at the very end about the big muddy monster or the Bigfoot type creature seen down in southern Illinois. Which is pretty awesome. This talk was done by Kevin Nelson. You may know Kevin from the Van Meter Visitor book. He also does a lot of different things with his buddy Chad Lewis. Good guy. But he did a great talk. A lot of good information about this cryptid found in southern Illinois. So went ahead and recorded the raw audio and got his okay to share it with all you listeners. This is raw audio, so you'll hear whispers, people in the background. There's a part where he, you know, has tech issues with his computer, so there's a few minutes downtime. You'll hear dogs barking. Maybe softly, maybe loud, but hey, that's part of the fun of the raw audio. Also, give their book, The Big Muddy Monster, check it out on their website or on Amazon, however you do that. And a lot more information in that book, and so I'm going to check it out as well. We'll do a review on the book and talk to him at the festival today. He's up for coming on the podcast when I give him a message on Facebook, and we'll have some more questions for him about the Big Muddy Monster. But go ahead, and for now, this raw audio is about 40 minutes, a lot of good info in it, so have fun, and again, you can always send us a audio message using Anchor. If you have any questions or anything that you want us to discuss, but go ahead and buckle up for the next 40 minutes with Kevin Nelson.
For about 20 years, and a simple mission to chronicle anomalous events, historical mysteries, urban legends, and the darker side of folklore. So, people say, well, you know, how do you get into this stuff? You know, where do you find these legends? Well, I roam the nation all the time, you know, from coast to coast, here in anywhere from Yosemite to Arizona, the Climb Hotel in Nevada. Black Angel, which some of you may be familiar with right here in Iowa, to White Sands, which is famous for UFO hunts, from Lake Champlain, the lake monster there, to vampire graves out in New England, to Hoodoo persons down in the southern swamps of Georgia, to northern Minnesota, and Wendigo houses out there. All the way to Mars, I'm just kidding. This is actually a volcano out in the Mojave Desert. So, let's dive in to the legend of the Big Muddy Monster. They call it the Big Muddy Monster because it's typically seen near a river called the Big Muddy. This is down in southern Illinois, and if you guys know where Carbondale is or Murphysboro, it's generally in that area. There's a river called the Big Muddy River that is where a lot of these settings take place, and that's how it got its name. It's a pretty tranquil and serene location. It's very hilly, lots of deep swamps, lots of places where something that's 7 or 8 feet tall could potentially hide. Again, here's the sign for the Big Muddy. One of the more interesting things that I discovered when I was down there doing the preparing the research for this is that in southern Illinois, they have some of the northernmost cypress swamps in the entire U.S. I always thought the cypress swamps were only in Louisiana and Mississippi and deep, deep south, but they extend as far north as Illinois. My co-author Chad here is standing next to the boat launch at the Big Muddy River. This is actually the location where a few of the sightings took place. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, just check. So, let's dive into it. So when we first looked into this book, in the research, we knew that there was a spike of sightings in the mid-70s. That was sort of the heyday of the big money monster stories. Of course, the early to mid-70s was the range, but there were a whole bunch of sightings. And when we first began this project, we thought that was mostly it. We knew there was another case in the 80s that we wanted to look into, but we thought the majority were in the 70s. However, the more we kept digging into the story, the timeline for this just kept getting pushed further and further and further back. And what we found was that these legends, which a lot of people thought started in the 70s, go much, much further. So they go back to 1915. People were already seeing strange creatures in southern Illinois. You know, there was livestock that was being attacked by things that they couldn't explain. Here's a headline from 1919. Strange animal attacking livestock, goats, cows, typically calves were found dead, mysteriously so. And it progressed. 1928 through 29. People were talking about a blood-sucking wolf. You know, this almost has shades of the chupacabra legends that we hear about today. You know, people were finding, again, animals dead, sometimes appearing like they were drained of their blood, and even hunting dogs. So at first, they were thinking, you know, there's this wolf under this, because what else would be down there preying upon these things? They'll have an occasional bear, but bears are very, very rare down there. Even so, they're a small black bear. And again, here's where they're saying, is this a wolf? You know, it's not unheard of, but it would have been very strange for southern Illinois. Let's move forward to 1942. Now, it's starting to look stranger. It's starting to look not just like a wolf or a bear, but people are starting to describe something that's much, much stranger. And this is when they start calling it the thing, for lack of a better term. What people initially were assuming, because of the reports being somewhat upright, ape-like, is they were saying, oh, well, the typical excuse you often hear, it must be a circus animal that somehow got away. You know, maybe a gorilla got loose from one of the traveling circuses. But there's no documentation whatsoever of any missing animals of that sort. And you hear this all around the country. You know, whenever there's a Bigfoot sighting back when anything strange, they're like, oh, it was a circus train that got derailed and all the animals escaped. And that's what you see. But it's kind of far-fetched. Again, here you see a headline, 1942, Carbondale. People are still thinking that it's this loose gorilla. Described being 8 feet tall, about 400 pounds. Now there's a reward for this thing. You know, more animals are turning up dead. People are starting to get worried. You know, they're like, all right, there's something here. We need to take care of this. Move forward into the 60s. The thing comes back. There's a little bit of a hiatus kind of in the late 40s and 50s where you don't get a whole lot of reports, at least that were documented. There easily could have been a lot of sightings and things, but from our investigation, we didn't turn up any hard concrete ones. It was more hearsay from the 50s. But once the 60s hit, the thing returned. 10 foot tall, a what's-it, that's reported being seen. 1968, 10 foot tall black creature from Chittyville. They call this the Chittyville monster. They're starting to see this pattern develop over the years in southern Illinois of this ape-like creature that people are starting to see. Some more headlines from the area. And this is where some of the first ones where they start calling it the money monster, because that was where some of the sightings were. This leads me to June of 1973. This is really when the full money monster legend kind of gets legs and really starts getting solidified into the local folklore of the Murphysboro, Carbondale area. Again, at Riverside Park, this is that location they saw Chad speaking of earlier. Here's the creature. People are seeing it. So in the early times, people were often describing it as kind of brown or black. However, by the 1970s, things had kind of shifted. Now all the descriptions are saying that it's white, or gray, or even blonde. Some people have theorized that, well, maybe if this was the same creature, perhaps it's just an older creature now, but it's the 60s to 70s. Others have theorized that, you know, if there's multiple creatures, they just come in just varying colors. Or perhaps it's the time of the year when they're seen. You know, they change color or color. So the Riverside incident is really interesting. It takes place, there's a young couple parked down in the park at night. I don't know what a young couple would do parking in a car in the middle of the night. But something comes up to their car. Randy Needham and Judy Johnson, they're talking in their car down by the Riverside, and something comes up to the car with this horrible, horrible stench. They said it smelled like rotten eggs or sulfur, you know, just this horrible sense, which again is a common thing that you see with Bigfoot cases. In any kind of case of high strangeness, they report this smell that's disgusting, almost like an open sewer. So Randy and Judy, of course, freak out. You know, this thing is right outside the door, it's looking in. However, it's not overtly threatening, you know, it's not smashing through the windows or anything like that. It's more just kind of approaching them and kind of curious, perhaps. So, I'll take it back a slide. Just a second. I'll be right back. Let me get this fixed up. This kind of stuff often happens when you talk about the paranormal. There we go. Here's another one. These are actual police photos that were taken at the scene. They described it as 18 inches from some of the ones that they got that were a little bit better, and from the descriptions. So, many, many years later, we interviewed Police Chief Ron Manuel. He's retired now, and he had some interesting things to say about that whole incident. So, when that couple had that experience, they immediately went to the police. And what's kind of interesting about it is one of the two is married, but not to the person that they were in the car with. So, and yet they still went to the police and made an official report on it. That's how scared they were about this thing and that it potentially hurt someone. They were willing to basically come clean about their story so that this could get out. So unless it was something legit, I can't think of many reasons that people would go to the police and admit something like that. So, and another thing that was kind of interesting, once they got there, the police were kind of first, you know, going through the woods, looking for these tracks, and while they were doing this, this scream came from the other side of the river, which isn't too far, it's maybe from here that far door. And this scream was so terrifying that one of the deputies dropped his gun and ran. And he got so much crap for it from the other police officers that he had to go back later on and retrieve his gun. But he was terrified. He said it did not sound human and it was scary. The next major sighting was the Westwood Hills incident. Randy Freeth and Cheryl Beck. They were sitting out, it's basically like a housing development that was very brand new at the time. But it butts up to a large wooded area that's part of a nature reserve that goes for acres and acres and acres. And while they were sitting on their back porch, they saw this creature. And I walked out of the woods, kind of looked around a bit, and of course they were stunned. You know, what is this thing that just stepped out of the window? And they couldn't believe what they saw. These are some of the actual eyewitness sketches that they drew. These are all in the police file. The one here, this is Randy Creeth's drawing, and this is Cheryl Ray's drawing. Or whatever it was that came out. I mean, clearly they're not trained artists, but this is what they were seeing. So after these two major sightings, it really started becoming an event, you could say, in Murphysboro. Everyone was talking about it at this point. It was starting to become a legend. Here you go again, shaggy creature of Murphysboro. Monster, not UFO, brings everywhere to town. And of course, whenever you have a rash of sightings like this, they call a flap in the cryptozoological world, you get people coming out of the woodworks wanting to hunt these things. So one of the groups that showed up was this team of ragtag guys. They were actually, two of them were attorneys. One was a newspaper editor, and I believe the other one was a hunter. They went down into the swamps south of Murphysboro, and there was a place called the Scatters. That's kind of the local term for the area. And they went on a camping expedition for it to hunt for this thing. And while they were camping in the middle of the night, they heard all these trees and they were breaking, and there was something thrashing about the woods that looked like, or sounded like, it wasn't very happy they were there. It was the middle of the night and they were freezing cold, so they were staying in their tents. In the morning when they went out to check it out, they found all these trees that had been snapped off, you know, at about eye level height. And some of these trees were 6-8 inches. It hadn't been storming or anything, just something was just raging through the woods around them to potentially scare them away, which it mostly did. Fast forward to 1988. One of the other major encounters, the Bob Ryman encounter. Bob Ryman owned a scrapyard on the edge of Murphysboro back then. And while he was working there, he was having a lot of trouble with teens breaking into cars and stealing car radios, things like that. So he hired a man as a night watchman to watch the place. And while he was doing this, this thing showed up in his scrapyard and he described it again. 7 or 8 feet tall, kind of whitish blonde in color, and it was just kind of walking around the scrapyard, staying in the shadows, and it didn't really want to be seen, you could tell, and he's watching it. And he said the creepiest part is it was making these strange sounds, almost like it was muttering or talking to itself in this, like, kind of almost a high-pitched voice. And he said, you know, seeing this high, or hearing this high voice come out of the house, massive creature, it was so strange that it really unsettled him. So he got on the phone, called Bob. Bob came running down, and he saw it too.
You're not going to need that.
And the watchman was like, should we do? Should we confront this thing? He was armed. He's like, should I shoot it? What should we do? And Bob's like, no, don't shoot it. I think it'll just make it angry. He's got a pistol. So they didn't. So what they did is they went inside a steel shed that was on my property. This is some of the shots in the scrapyard. They described it as a red glowing eye. It's kind of unusual. Not many natural animals have red glowing eyes. So here's their, again, real artistic eyewitness sketch of what they saw in the scrapyard that night. One thing that was really interesting on the footnote is they said that it seemed fairly well groomed, the hair, like it wasn't full of leaves and debris. They said it seemed like from about here down to about the waist, it seemed like fairly nice hair that an animal would have for the most part. And then once it got below the waist, that's where it was caked in mud, in various degree of forest litter, things like that. Another drawing of the creature. This is one that appeared in the newspaper at the time. So they locked themselves in this steel shed because they're like, well, we don't think we can hurt this thing, but it might be able to hurt us. And while they were in there, this thing started throwing large rocks at the side of the shed. And they think that it was just kind of playing with them or trying to scare them, because they were fully convinced that if this thing wanted to, it could have ripped one of the sides of the shed clean off. I mean, this thing was powerful. Here's a shot of the rock throwing. So, around the same time,
so I want to take a few minutes out just to share something with you. If you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast, so let me explain. It's free. There's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer, and Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and a lot more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership, and it's everything you need to make a podcast in one place. Just download the app and make a podcast today. It's that easy. All right, back to the action.
In the 70s, people were seeing this creature over in Missouri that was called the Missouri Monster, or Mole. So there's all these sightings going on. And again, Lauren Coleman at the time referred to a lot of these creatures from that part of the region in the swamps and things, abominable swamp slobs. So that kind of stuff. These are two recent books that just came out this fall. The one on the left is Lyle Blackburn's Momo book that just came out. And then 2 weeks ago, the documentary from Small Town Monsters came out. So there's all kinds of weird stuff happening down the area in the mid-70s. Again, here's Momo compared to Big Muddy. Momo was very dark, had this shaggy head, a massive mound of hair around his head, whereas Big Muddy was typically seen as more whitish blonde or gray, just to contrast the two together. The other difference is some people describe Big Muddy as having ears that kind of either stuck out or stuck up. They have some kind of prominent ear, whereas Momo looked more like some kind of 80s rock star for the most part. So after 6 years of research, here's Linda over here should find this interesting. She had a similar thing happen to her before this. So when we went to the police department, they actually had a file that said Big Muddy Monster, 1973. I mean, this was like something right out of the X-Files. So I think that when you see this kind of thing, that it only happens in the movies, but they don't really do that. Some places actually do that. Linda had this happen right when she looked at the Beast of Bray Road in Elkhorn. They had a file that said werewolf. So this stuff really does happen. Here's the file with some of the witness drawings, the photos. And this is all public information. Anyone that wants to can go look at them anytime they want. So we kept digging. And we heard rumors that that there's a lot more sightings that have been publicized, that sightings were still happening, and that evidence perhaps still existed. So we knew a few people down there. One of them is one of my good friends, Tony Girard. He's a biologist that teaches down there. And he said that he would keep his ears open if he hears anything. So about a year and a half later, I get a text from him saying, hey, I talked to this woman, she thinks she has something. And I'm like, okay, well, what is something? And he's like, she thinks or says that she has a plaster cast of big money from the 1970s. So we're like, great, I gotta see this. So Chad and I went down there. The story is, real quickly, her father in the 1970s was out coming home from work late at night. He saw a preacher on the side of the road, and it looked nothing he'd ever seen before, that fit the big money description. And he went home, got his son, they went out there to see if they could see it again. It was all gone, they found the footprints. They came back the next day with a Boy Scout team and made plaster casts of his footprints. They also made impressions of the cast into another piece of plaster, which is what you see here. So she's been sitting on these in her basement for 40 years. There's a close-up. They even described in the back, February 9th, 1975. That's when the impression was made. So, within the book, we get into sort of a larger picture here of what is going on down in Southern Illinois. Why are people having all these weird experiences? And one of the things that we encountered was there's all kinds of creatures down there. It's not just big money. And so like, is this part of a trend or a bigger picture? So I ran across this book called Weird Egypt. And so for those that don't know, the southern part of Illinois is called Little Egypt. That's what the locals call it. There's a whole bunch of reasons why they even named their towns down there after Egyptian cities. Cairo, Illinois, which is a ridiculous pronunciation of Cairo, but that's what they call it. There's Thebes down there, there's Karnak down there. Anyway, while reading Weird Egypt by Jim Jones, he had a theory that because of the fault lines that riddle the area, sort of like a cracked eggshell, that are constantly under pressure, that are constantly shifting, they're ejecting basically electromagnetic fields at all varying intensities at different times. And then he was like, well, I wonder if there's any correlation. Is there any relationship between these fault lines and all these strange occurrences? So what he did was he made a map of his hometown of Carbondale. He mapped out all the houses in town that had strange stories, like hauntings and things like that, walls of light that people had reported. And after doing so, after mapping these out on a map, he overlaid that with where the fault lines were running underneath Carbondale, and they lined up exactly. He called these paranormal corridors that were running through the town. And so his theory was, is that this pressure that's going on down there and the electromagnetic energy that's occasionally released is what's causing some of these events. There's all kinds of theories on why or how. One of those could be that they've proven that when your brain is subject to high levels of electromagnetic radiation, that you can see things or, you know, perhaps hallucinate. So are these people hallucinating, or are these high fields instead enabling something to see something that's there but they can't normally see? It could go either way. This is Little Egypt here. This is a visual of roughly where it's at. State. John Keel wrote the Mothman Prophecies, talks about window areas. Typically, they're a lot more localized than this, but some people have theorized that Illinois, at least the southern tip, especially along these fault lines where they intersect, could be potential window areas. So many other creatures that are popping up down there. How many of you have heard of Enfield Horror? Around the same time, Enfield, Illinois, not too far from Murphysboro, this thing shows up in town with three legs and saucer-shaped pinkish-red eyes. So it's hopping around the town and terrorizing people. Here's one artist's version of it, Enfield Horror. Another one. Most of the sightings happen along this rail line. This is what it looks like today. This is the gentleman, Henry McDaniel, that saw this creature. He was one of the ones that gave the reports. And when he described it, a lot of people just wrote it off. They're like, oh, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. He probably saw something, but based on his descriptions, he probably saw a kangaroo, you know, the two legs, and then he mistook the tail for a third leg, or something ridiculous like that. Here's the problem. When he was in the military and serving overseas, he had a kangaroo for a pet. He knew what kangaroos looked like, so highly unlikely that he would mistake what he was very familiar with. Here he is again describing it. These are some of the reports from the time that appeared in newspapers. Eyes as big as flashlights, three legs, pink eyes. And again, this is where Enfield is in relation to the state. But the Enfield horror wasn't the only one. There's also a creature that later became known as the Tuttle Bottoms monster. Tuttle Bottoms is by Harrisburg, 1963. In the swamps. People are talking about this thing that they keep seeing back there, and then people ask them, well, what did it look like? You know, this time it wasn't ape-like. It wasn't three legs with red glowing eyes. Instead, this time, they describe it as a giant anteater-like creature. So again, you start getting stories like, oh, this thing escaped from a circus, it escaped from a zoo, that kind of thing. No evidence of that whatsoever. But multiple people, including a police officer, saw this creature in the swamps that they described as looking like a giant anteater. So while writing the book, I was like, all right, I'm gonna use Jim Jones' theory that he applied to Carbondale and see if maybe Harrisburg in the Tuttle Bottoms lies along one of these anomaly corridors as he described it. So I went through some geological maps, figured out where the fault lines were under Harrisburg. Sure enough, there's a fault line that goes right under the Tuttle Bottoms. So is this one of the reasons that people are seeing these things? I don't know. I'm not a geologist, but it's interesting. Again, people say, no, it's an escaped circus animal. You'd think someone would go looking for it at least a little bit if it was. So here's our ragtag team in the Tuttle Bottoms. The one in the puffy blue shirt, that's Tony Girard. He's the biologist I referred to earlier. And then the other two are some folklorists and authors that live down there that kind of assisted us on this case. Really good time. This is the Tuttle Bottoms. As you can see, it's just endless marsh and swamps as far as you can see. So a lot of things can hide back there. So what are these things? Some other creatures that, if time permitted, I can go and call them. I can probably speak all weekend about all these things that people have seen down there. There's the Coal Hollow Monster, the Mount Vernon Monster, the Central Something, the Moro Monster. These are all different towns and they have their own various legends. Some people say, well, it's gotta be a hoax. You know, if these things existed, people would be seeing them, there'd be, you know, corpses or, you know, whether it's Bigfoot or carcasses, if it's something like a giant alligator, people would find these things. Maybe, maybe not. This is a huge area. Down there is the Shawnee National Forest, which is over a million acres of just huge swamp hills and woods. It's huge. So people say, oh, well, it's probably a guy dressed up as Bigfoot, or a monster suit of some sort, or perhaps a person in a ghillie suit. We thought about that, and again, it is a possibility, but if you look at all the reports down there of all these posses that were being formed and hunting parties looking for these things, you know, probably a lot of drunk guys with guns going out in the woods looking, I'm going to get Bigfoot. I'm going to get the Tuttle Bottoms monster. Probably not the smartest thing to do to go walking around through the woods dressed as a monster with all these hunting parties and all this. The other option that people say, well, maybe it's not truly a monster. Maybe what people are seeing are people, just feral people, wild men. About 2 weeks ago, when I was in Lexington, Kentucky at CryptidCon, I heard David Politis speak. He's into cryptozoology, but he's mostly into mysterious missing person reports. He used to work with the FBI, things like that. Anyway, one of his theories is that what people are seeing with Bigfoot isn't actually a primate, it's actually, they're technically human. They're just a form of feral human that is of the type that we don't know. And that's why when people find hair or various DNA samples and have them tested, they keep coming back as human, because they are. And the analogy that he gave is like, this could be a subset of human, like almost like a tribe that is undiscovered. And he said, the difference would be, you know, if you have a poodle and you you have a mastiff dog. Canines, they're both dogs, but physically and visually, they're going to be very, very different creatures. And that's kind of a comparison he gave between what we, the modern human, and these other perhaps feral humans that could be living in pockets down there. One of the theories too is that perhaps prior to European arrival, there were a lot more of these things, perhaps in their own tribes. And that when Europeans arrived, they were susceptible to the same kinds of diseases that a lot of Native Americans are. We know that prior to white arrival, that this whole land was covered with Native Americans and tribes, you know, millions and millions. But due to smallpox and various other Western diseases, you know, the vast majority were wiped out fairly quickly within a few hundred years. If the same thing happened to these creatures or feral humans, that could explain why they only exist in very small pockets, perhaps Southern Illinois, perhaps Kentucky, perhaps the Pacific Northwest, where people are still seeing these things. So, back to big money. Murphysboro, again, it's become this popular legend. It's kind of big. They have a festival now. The Big Light Brewing Company is based out of Murphysboro. They have their own beer based on the legend. As I was telling Linda earlier today, one of my criteria for when a creature really makes it big time, when it's a true cryptid, is when it has a beer name. That's when you know you've really made it. So I'm holding out that someday someone will come up with a band name to visit for beer. So I think it'll happen. Here's a big money porter. It's delicious. And coming, it's right around the corner. If any of you are going to be in Southern Illinois, they're having the Big Money Monster Brew Fest. They celebrate the legend of the monster. Down at the park up in the riverboat, the boat landing is, it's a big park. The whole thing fills up with different microbrews and people having fun and live music, all kinds of stuff. And lots of beer. So, kind of wrap it up there, but I think we might have a minute or two for some questions. 5 minutes of questions if anyone has anything or comments.
Anybody ever use
Well, as far as I know, no one has. I mean, officially, my suspicion is that if there is something down there, they do know, because there is a military, I don't want to say it's a base, but it's a military facility not too far from Murphysboro, and it's very similar to the old TNT factory that's outside Point Pleasant, Mothman, let's say. A lot of it's abandoned now, but some of it's still full of TNT and explosives and things like that. Once in a while, one of them just ripped off, just blows up. But it's just been stored there for so long, like it's kind of volatile. But one of the theories is that they know these things exist, but they're just kind of just not saying anything. You know, as long as they don't become too high profile or work people or whatever, they'll just figure it out of me. Yeah, well, all the fault lines are well known. What they do, they connect to the New Madrid fault line, which is, okay, I have to pull it up and back up. Kind of in that tip of Illinois and Kentucky, where everything kind of comes together, where Ohio meets the Mississippi. Right along there, that's about where the New Madrid fault line is. And it's been building up pressure for a long time. Back in the 1800s, there was a major earthquake there that was so strong, the Mississippi River flowed backwards for a while. So, they say that they're waiting for the next big one, and so some of these scientific events that they're experiencing could be, just, you know, precursors to something that's going to happen. One of the other geological features down there that's not too far from Murphysboro that we address in the book and talk about quite extensively is a feature called the Higgs Dome, and it's basically an ancient lava dome where the crust of the earth kind of bubbles up like this. It's an area that's under higher pressure than most areas. And so it's not technically a fault line, it's more like this pressure model that's been built up. And a lot of weird stuff happens around that. Anything from headless ghost stories to monster stories. I mean, just, it's a hot, you know, perhaps even call it, you know, a window area. Is it related to this geological formation? I can't say. But it's interesting that you get these clusters around these things.
And that guy's map lines up on the wall.
Yeah, exactly. So, any other questions or comments? I would love to do that. It's definitely something that we consider doing. I mean, the only problem is this whole area is so hard to access. I mean, it's just deep spot. I mean, unless you're a swamp boat or, you know, and it's, I mean, just wearing waders, basically, walking through it is just exhausting. And, you know, there's no power out there. I mean, it's just bring all the gear that you need to get deep in there. It's a difficult task. Let alone moving silently enough to not scare something off. But yeah, I do some kind of reconnaissance with a drone. One of my former jobs, I used to fly drones, and you know, they would give you a map for that before. But yeah, something that had like an IR they could do at night, because a lot of these reports say that these things are mostly out there, which makes sense. If they don't want to be seen or found out. So, you know, again, you can't really hide from that kind of thing.
No one ever captured more on a game camera?
I've heard stories of people that have seen, you know, anomalous things on their game cameras. Also people that say, you know, their game cameras are stripped off trees, or that the trees smashed that they were on. So there's almost an indication that these things might have just enough intelligence to know that this thing shouldn't be here. You know, that it looks out of place as they smash it. So, you know, it's hard to say. But maybe one more question. Otherwise, I mean, we may have a couple books left out there. I know that we went pretty quick, but, you know, hopefully I can answer all your questions in there. Awesome. You've been a great crowd. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks for listening today, guys. Again, that was Kevin Nelson from the Van Meter Visitor Festival in Van Meter, Iowa, 2019, talking about the Big Muddy Monster. If you haven't already and you're just checking out this podcast on iTunes or wherever you listen to your podcast, go over to Instagram and follow us at Bigfoot Society. There's a great content and discussion over there. You'll want to get involved there. It's a good time. And some other links you can check out as well. But, you know, like and subscribe and review the podcast. Give us some good reviews about what you think so far. And definitely subscribe to the podcast as well, because we'll be coming out with some more content in the next few months. We're getting some interviews revved up again. So, as always, thanks for listening, and we'll chat with you next time.